All right, today we are jumping into a big one. It's an idea that won a Nobel Prize, and it helps answer one of the most fascinating questions in all of economics. We're talking about the Solow Growth Model.
So let me ask you this. Have you ever wondered why some developing economies seem to be growing at lightning speed, while the big, wealthy, established ones are, well, growing much, much slower? It feels kind of backwards, doesn't it? You'd think the richest countries would always be the ones pulling ahead, but that's not what we see. So what is going on?
Well, it turns out the answer is hiding inside a truly brilliant model from an economist named Robert Solow. Seriously, this idea is so powerful it became the foundation for how we think about economic growth, and it solves this exact puzzle for us.
Okay, so to really wrap our heads around this, we need to start with the two basic building blocks of the whole thing, capital and labor.
Think about it. Every economy pretty much runs on two main things. You've got labor, that's easy enough, it's just all the people out there doing work, and then you have the second piece, capital. And this, my friends, is where things get really interesting.
Now this is absolutely critical. When an economist says capital, they are not talking about money. Nope. They're talking about the actual physical stuff an economy uses to produce things. We're talking factories, roads, power grids, internet cables, you name it. It's the physical hardware of a nation that's been built up over time.
So how do we think about this? It's really about a stock versus a flow. Capital is the stock. It's all the stuff, all the infrastructure that a country has right now. Investment, on the other hand, is the flow. It's the new stuff we add to the pile each and every year. So this year's investment becomes part of next year's capital stock. Simple as that.
So, if investment is the engine pushing the economy forward, adding more and more capital, what's holding it back? Well, there's another force at play here, one that acts like the brakes on a car, and that force is called depreciation.
So here's the fundamental tug of war. On one side, you have investment, which is building new factories and roads. But on the other side, you've got depreciation. That's just the natural wear and tear of everything. You know, roads get potholes, machines break down, buildings get old. You only get real, actual growth when the new stuff you're adding from investment is more than the old stuff you're losing to decay.
And that leads to a really simple but profound conclusion. The more stuff you have, the more stuff breaks. Right? A small country with just one highway doesn't have a big repair bill. But a huge developed country with a massive network of roads and power grids, their maintenance bill is gigantic. That depreciation is a constant massive drag on their economy.
And believe it or not, with just that one simple idea, we have everything we need to finally crack the code on our original question.
This chart is the big aha moment. Just look at this. In a rich developed country, a huge chunk of their investment money, maybe something like 75%, is just spent fixing what's already broken. They're basically running just to stand still. Only a tiny slice goes to building brand new things. But now look at a developing country. They have very little old stuff to fix, so almost all of their investment, like 90% of it, goes into building shiny new factories and infrastructure. That is almost pure rocket fuel growth.
Think about it this way. Wealthy nations have to pour unbelievable amounts of cash in every year just to keep things from falling apart. Imagine the cost of just maintaining all the roads and bridges in the United States. That money isn't driving new growth, it's just preventing the whole system from decaying. Developing countries, they just don't have that heavy burden, so every dollar they invest pushes them forward.
So this model gives us this incredibly elegant explanation for catch-up growth, but its legacy, its importance, is so much bigger than just this one question.
So why do we still care about this today? Because the Solow model is basically the operating system for modern economics. It's the benchmark that every other growth theory is compared to. When you hear politicians arguing about tax policy or savings rates, they are playing in the sandbox that Solow built. It gives us the core logic for how a country can build lasting prosperity.
But this brings us to one last, really deep insight from the model. Because of that pesky depreciation, you can't grow forever just by piling up more machines. Eventually, you're just replacing old junk. So that leaves us with a massive question. If more capital isn't the secret to infinite growth, then what is? And that very question is what has pushed economics forward for decades, forcing us to look at things like technology, innovation, and new ideas as the true engines of growth.
Welcome
Today, we are going to build, from the ground up, one of the most powerful models economists have for understanding economic growth. We're going to put it together piece by piece, and by the end, you'll see exactly how the engine of an economy really works.
All right, let's jump in. Here's our game plan. We're going to start with the big central question, and then we'll do something really clever. We'll shift our view down to the individual worker. After that, we'll lay down the basic rules of this little economic universe, follow the money to see where it all goes, and finally, we'll uncover the critical link that actually fuels all the growth.
So first things first, we have to start with the one question that really motivates this entire model, and honestly, a huge chunk of economics itself.
This is the great puzzle, isn't it? Why are some countries incredibly wealthy while others struggle? How can some nations just take off like a rocket while others seem stuck in place? Answering this mystery is the whole point, and models like the one we're building today are the main tools economists use to crack the case.
Okay, on to our first real building block. And it's a really simple but powerful idea. We're just going to change our perspective a little bit, and that's going to make the whole problem way easier to solve. We're zooming in from the whole economy to the experience of the average worker.
So, at the highest level, you can think of an economy as having two basic ingredients. You've got capital, which we'll call big K, that's all the physical stuff, you know, the machines, the factories, the computers. And then you have labor, or big L, which is just all the people doing the work.
But here's the twist, and this is absolutely crucial. The total amount of capital in a country isn't what's most important. What really drives everything is how much capital the average worker gets to use. We call this little K, or capital per worker. And the math is super simple. Just take all the capital, big K, and divide it by all the workers, big L.
So to make this real, let's say an economy has 200 machines and 100 workers. Well, then the capital per worker, our little K, is just 2. It seems almost too simple, but trust me, this little shift to thinking per worker unlocks the entire model.
All right, so we've got our input set up on a per worker basis. Now we need to establish some ground rules for how production actually happens. Think of these as the two fundamental laws of physics for our model's universe.
The first rule is called constant returns to scale. And it's a very intuitive idea. It just says that if you double all of your inputs, you double your capital, and you double your labor, guess what? You're going to get exactly double the output. If you scale everything up by some amount z, your output scales up by that exact same amount. Simple enough, right?
Now, the second rule is a little more subtle, but I guarantee you've experienced this one in your own life. It's all about what happens when you keep adding more capital, but you keep the number of workers the same.
Think about it like this. Give a writer their very first laptop, and their productivity goes through the roof. It's a huge deal. Now, give them a second laptop. Is it helpful? Yeah, maybe they can leave one at home. It adds a little bit of value. What about a third laptop? At that point, the benefit is basically zero. That's diminishing marginal product. Each new piece of capital is just a little less useful than the one before it.
And here's what that looks like when you graph it. You see that? The curve shoots up really steeply at first. That's when those first few units of capital are having a massive impact. But then it starts to flatten out. It's still going up, but each step forward gets smaller and smaller. The slope just keeps decreasing.
Okay, so our capital and labor have been busy and they've produced a bunch of stuff. They've created output, which is really just another word for income. So the next logical question is, where does all that income go?
We're going to start with a pretty famous equation from economics, the national income identity. It says that all the income in an economy, that's Y, is either spent by consumers, C, invested by businesses, I, or spent by the government, G. Now, to keep our model simple for now, we're just going to assume there's no governments, so G is zero. That leaves us with a really clean result. All output is either consumed or invested. That's it.
And you probably know what's coming next, right? We do the same thing we did before. We put it all in our per worker terms. So output per worker, little y, is equal to consumption per worker, little c, plus investment per worker, little I. Same idea, just scale down to our average person.
All right, it is time for the final piece of the puzzle. This is where we connect all the dots we've laid out, and we're going to see the true engine of growth in this model finally kick into gear.
So every economy has what's called a savings rate, and we'll just call it S. It's simply the fraction of income that people save instead of spend. Now, for our model, we're going to treat this number as a given. We're not trying to explain it, it just is. That's what economists mean when they say a variable is exogenous. It comes from outside the model.
So, let's say a country has a savings rate of 18%. That just means that for every single dollar of income that's earned, 82 cents get spent on consumption right away, and the other 18 cents get saved for later. It's that basic trade-off we all make.
Okay, now get ready for the big aha moment. This is where it gets really cool. A minute ago, we said that all output is either consumed or invested, so Y equals C plus I. And we just defined that all output is also either consumed or saved, so Y equals C plus S. Well, look at those two equations. If Y equals both C plus I and C plus S, there's only one possible conclusion. Investment must be equal to savings. I must equal S.
And that right there is the punchline. Investment is the thing that builds new capital, more machines, better factories, new tools. And we just figured out that investment is funded entirely by savings. So the total amount of investment in our economy is simply the savings rate, S, times the total output, Y. It's a direct link.
And this gives us the final piece of our visual puzzle. Since investment is just a fraction of our total output, the curve for investment on our graph is going to have the exact same shape as our production curve. It's just a smaller version of it, sitting right underneath.
And there we have it. We have just built the core engine of a Nobel Prize-winning economic model. We've connected capital to output, and we've connected output right back to the savings and investment that creates new capital. It's a full circle. And look, as the lecturer who inspired this whole explainer said himself, it is totally normal if this feels like a lot to take in at once. There's some real cognitive load here.
So, we've successfully built our engine of growth. Savings becomes investment, investment builds more capital, and more capital leads to more output. But, hang on a second, if that was the whole story, shouldn't economies just grow forever and ever? We know they don't. So, that leaves us with one final fascinating question. What puts the brakes on this powerful engine? And we'll dig into that next time.